Good evening, across America and around the world. You're listening to the Hour of the Time.
I'm Doyle.
And I'm William Cooper. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I trust you had a glorious weekend. We certainly did. Got a lot of rest and winter's here.
Yep.
What happened this morning, Doyle, as you walked out into the backyard and took a stroll?
Well, half the plants were laying on the ground, and the bird bath was frozen solid.
Frozen solid.
We knocked on it.
It was cold last night. My little daughter, Allison, has a habit of getting up in the middle of the night instead of going to the bathroom in the hall. She must come into our room and use our bathroom, and so she always wakes me up, and either Annie or I will get up and let her in and take her in and turn the bathroom light and wait patiently while she takes care of her business and then take her back in her room and tuck her in. Well, she did this like three times last night. And it was cold. It was cold. And finally, the last time she did it was 3 a.m., and it was so cold I could not and did not go back to sleep for the rest of the night, although I tried valiantly. I gave a good try, was unable to do that. So now, today, Annie put the electric blanket on the bed, and we have buttoned up the house. We got up this morning and had a cup of coffee with Crusher. And then Crusher and I took a long walk in the morning air, and there was a definite snap.
Yeah.
Definite snap. It was very chilly. Of course, I told you before that I thought that winter would be early this year and colder than normal, and I still believe that. I have no scientific reason for saying that other than I have a neighbor who has a weeping willow tree, and the leaves on the weeping willow tree began to close last month. When a weeping willow closes its leaves, ladies and gentlemen, it means it's going to be cold very quick, and it is. Of course, we live at 7,500 feet. I have no idea what the winter is going to be like where you are. This is just my feeling for where I am. And in my lifetime, the scale of how cold it's going to be and when winter is going to come, as measured by the leaves of the willow tree, the weeping willow tree, have never failed to be right on the money. And so just yesterday, Doyle and I were discussing the fact that it was getting cold very early for the end of September and the beginning of October, and that we could anticipate a freeze some night soon, and sure enough, unbeknownst to us, it was the night coming, and it froze. So we even had Justin bring up another load of alligator juniper for the fireplace and the wood stove, and we have another cord on order, and we've already got several cords out there, but we have to build up 7 cords of wood for the winter. You know what I just said? Oh, we're going to get all the letters from the tree huggers, aren't we? Oh my goodness, telling us what terrible people we are.
It looks pretty when it burns, though.
Oh, it's beautiful when it burns. Nothing better than sitting in front of a wood fire on a cold winter's night and just enjoying the warmth and the camaraderie of the family and the children, mm-hmm. and the fireplace. It's just wonderful. And we do every year. Our home is heated with wood heat. Wood heat. Wood heat, wood heat, wood heat. And there's plenty of trees for everybody. And more trees get planted every year than were ever cut the previous year by those who cut the trees. And those who take care of the trees. And those who maintain private property and all kinds of things. For instance, since we moved here, we have personally planted, gosh, I couldn't even count how many trees we've planted. Around the house and in the forest, we have planted probably close to 60 trees, maybe. Just around the house, it's got to be 20-something.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And so that's that's that. Most people don't know, and this is a fact, ladies and gentlemen, that in the 20s, most of the forests in this country had been cut down. and there weren't too many left. And since the 20s, the foresters, the lumbermen, the people who depend upon lumber for a living, and the ranchers and people who owned property have replanted and regrown America's forests almost, not quite, but almost to the state that they were. And they continue to grow. And the people continue to plant trees. All of this environmental hoopla that says that we're on the verge of extinction and we're going to run out of wood and all that kind of stuff. You know, it's real funny. I was at one of these people's house, I guess maybe 2 years ago, a person in California whom I know that belongs to the Sierra Club. And don't get me wrong, folks, not all that they do is bad, and they don't think that they're doing any bad anyway. They believe in what they're doing, and they believe they're doing good. But amidst the tirades about the destruction of the forests and the wilderness and all of this kind of stuff, I watched this person, as she cooked dinner, use two entire rolls of paper towels. And she never gave it a thought. She never thought of it as paper. These were rags, dish rags, and mop up the, you know, and you don't wash them. I mean, you wash your hands in the sink, and you take one, and you dry off your hands, and you throw it away. Well, it's not dirty. You just wash your hands, and you just dry the water off, and it gets thrown in the trash can. But sometimes it's two or three to dry your hands, and two or three to wipe the countertop, and then three or four to wipe the stove, and so on and so forth. And some people even dry their dishes with them. It's amazing, you know. We use wood for the fireplace, but we very seldom use paper towels. We used to, until we took a good look at it and realized that that is a terrible waste, and there's no justification for it whatsoever. And so we very seldom use them unless we absolutely need something like that for some particular job. Anyway. That's really neither here nor there. But it was fun to talk about. Let me see. We have ordered, ladies and gentlemen, should be here tomorrow, a new modem. This is a great modem. It's made especially for business. And although we do not engage in business, we purchased this modem because it will do what we need it to do. It has a complete voicemail system, where we can put descriptions of items and prices and all kinds of things on there. You know, push this if you want to know that. If you want to talk to a real person, push this and an alarm will go off and wake up half the city. And it also has fax capabilities and all kinds of neat things. And it's also one of the fastest modems that there is, which... Should facilitate a lot of communications that we don't have right now because of old, outdated equipment. And so this is going to take care of some of that. So once again, you will soon be able to fax us, and we'll be able to call at any hour of the day or night according to your schedule and find out whatever you want to know. It will be on this voicemail system, and you don't have to wake us up, or we don't have to answer the phone if we're, you know, engaged in... really busy stuff, and we will try very hard to maintain our schedule of actually answering the phone ourselves between 1 and 5 in the afternoon if you want to actually talk to Doyle or myself or Annie or Pooh or Allison or Crusher or Sugar Bear or, you know, any of the caterpillars out in the garden. Or
a lot of them to talk to.
A lot of them to talk to. Way too many. As a matter of fact, way too many of them to talk to. We actually had a caterpillar invasion this year.
Yeah, pestilence.
Mm-hmm. Incredible. It's like the plagues of the Bible. Caterpillars everywhere. Squish, squish. Mm-hmm. You walked along, squish, squish. And you could. There were so many of them, you could actually hear them eating the plants. And so, in the best intentions of good gardening. We plucked them off one by one with our fingers and with sticks and with gloves and all kinds of stuff, because some of these caterpillars have little like bristly hairs on them that will sting you. Didn't know that, did you? Caterpillars can be dangerous. Some of them, not all of them. Mm-hmm. Not even most of them, but some of them can. Remember, this is Arizona. Lots of poisonous things in Arizona. Tarantulas and black widows and spiders you've never seen before in your life. And they look like, well, you talk about aliens. If there's an alien, it's some of these spiders, I got to tell you. And harmless horny toads and Gila monsters and rattlesnakes and coral snakes and scorpions you name it, we have it. Centipedes, big centipedes, big, long, ugly centipedes, and stink bugs and crickets and skunks and rabbits. And when we take a walk in the morning, we flush out at least two or three rabbits, which should have already been in their dens by that time. And at night, if we go out and hook up our 1.5 million candle power spotlight, which we use to patrol our perimeter, you can literally see hundreds of rabbits covering the mountaintop up here, all over the place. So, even if we ran out of food, folks, there's no way in the world we could starve or thirst. Not at all. We could eat those little critters, and if we absolutely had to, we could drink their blood. That sounds terrible, doesn't it? But when you're in a survival situation, believe me, you'll do whatever you have to survive. And I'm telling you, I'm no different than you. If you'll do whatever you have to survive, you can bet your boots I will too. So that's the name of that tune. You know, over the years, I have found it absolutely amazing that during the presidency of Republican presidents, the so-called left-wing socialists have run absolutely amok with conspiracy theories. Conspiracy theory. Yes, I'm telling you. You know, wasn't it all, if you read all these books about who assassinated President John F. Kennedy, and you listen to all these lectures, they're all left-wing, radical socialists. Every single one of those people, without exception. And they all point to the right-wing as the people who killed John F. Kennedy. Well, we all know who killed Kennedy, and we've revealed that on this broadcast. Not the exact people who pulled the trigger, but the organization responsible. And so those of you who have been listening to this broadcast for many years, you know that. They left their signature all over the place. You couldn't miss it unless you were blind, deaf, dumb, and absolutely socialist. And then you'd only miss it because you wouldn't want to admit it. And that, folks, is the way it is moving west. And wasn't it the Republicans who were always responsible for bringing dope into the country, a la the Socialist Christic Institute? And I can go on and on and on. Everything was a conspiracy, and it was all flushed out and revealed and written about by left-wing socialists. Now, if you don't believe me, go back and read all this stuff from the time when Nixon was president, and when Ford was president, and when Bush was president, and you'll see that it's true. In between presidents that happened to be Democrat, like Jimmy Carter, you see all that stuff just sort of disappears. And then, you know, there's always the people who are trying to flush out the truth of the situation who just keep on going, and nobody says anything about them until, ladies and gentlemen, we got a Republican Congress and a Democrat president, just the opposite of the way it was before. And now all these left-wing socialists, all these little Hitlers, are running around pointing to the so-called right-wing as being conspiracy theorists who are still pointing to the very same people with the very same proof that they have always been pointing to, that have been ignored throughout the run of the socialist left-wing conspiracy theory in vogue era. Isn't that amazing? So now, all of these left-wing wacko socialists, which, by the way, is another code word for Democrat, and, believe it or not, Republican. Remember I told you there isn't a dime's worth of difference between the two? And if Clinton were to resign tomorrow, and Al Gore were to become ill and resign also, and whoever was next in line just happened to be a Republican and became a president, nothing would change, ladies and gentlemen. We would still be going right into the New World totalitarian socialist order. World government, that's the name of the game. And that, folks, is where we're headed. Whether you know it or not, whether you believe it or not, you're going to find out. So, you know, stick around. It will, I guarantee you, become obvious. Like a bird on the wild, let it roam in an old Nissan wild. I have tried in my way to be free. Like a worm on a hook, like a knife bent down in some old fashioned book. It was the shape of our love that twisted me. If I unless, of course, you've been drinking a lot of beer. Then you got freedom from everything. You don't even know where you're at. You don't know what you're feeling. If somebody scared you to death, you wouldn't know it. And of course, they don't want anything. They're too high to want anything. Freedom from what? Freedom from fear. Who are you trying to kid, JL? Don't you know Roosevelt made that stuff up? It ain't anywhere in the writings of the Founding Fathers. This sure isn't protected in the Constitution. No, sir. The socialist myth. Ask the Russians if you don't believe me. They had freedom from want and freedom from fear. They pretended to work. State pretended to pay them. The only ones who made out were the vodka factory. Everybody was drunk 90% of the time. They didn't know what they wanted. They had no idea if they were afraid. And the state made sure there was plenty of vodka. And the next year, they double the potato crop. Well, they could never run out. Ain't socialism grand?
It's a ball of smile.
Don't you just love it? I'm going to read you an article now because I know there's a lot of you out there shaking your head saying, and the left-wing socialists never had no conspiracy theories. Cooper, you're full of it. Well, those of you who are saying that, get ready. Get ready to reach up and start pulling your foot out of your mouth, because I'm going to document it for you right now. Like we always do on this show. Give you the facts. Something most of you out there never heard of. Facts. In case you don't know it, it's not spelled R-E-S-P-E-C-T. R-E-S-P-E-C-T is spelled F-A-C-T-S. F-A-C-T-S. Repeat after me. Everybody stand up. Stand up. All you socialists, raise your left hand and say F-A-C-T-S. F-A-C-T-S. I will deal with F-A-C-T-S. I will deal with F-A-C-T-S. Of course, we know you won't. But wasn't that fun? And you all got some exercise. I have in front of me a left-wing socialist magazine. Published May the 28th, 1968. May the 28th, 1968. May the 28th, 1968. Look magazine. This was a left-wing, and still is, left-wing, liberal, what they call liberal. The truth is, people who want and love freedom are liberals. Everybody else is not. And it has articles in here about Soviet chairmans of this and that and the other thing. And has a big, long article on the new liberalism. For those of you trying to call in, we're not going to pick up the phone until I'm ready. Here's an article on page 27, a new liberal manifesto. A new liberal manifesto says liberalism today is weary, cautious, and worst of all, dull. Old line liberal leaders bent on blocking real change are in fact conservatives. They tell the truth. And those who call themselves conservative today are really left-wing socialists, ladies and gentlemen. There's no doubt about it. All you got to do is stop listening to what they say and start watching what it is that they do. The article says, here is a new liberalism. There are signs that its time is coming. And it outlines the fact that they will do and say anything to get their way. And we all know that, don't we? Because that's exactly what has happened. The left today has resorted to the big lie. Chronic. It's as if they can't tell the truth and never will tell the truth. They bend everything. They spin everything. They change history. Like Clinton's assertion that he is a Jeffersonian Democrat. Now that's one of the biggest lies I've ever heard in my life. Thomas Jefferson, were he alive today, would not only disown the Democratic Party, but would go to war against it. Also, the Republicans. They pretend, ladies and gentlemen, to oppose each other, but you notice there's only one agenda that's ever served, the socialist agenda. Doesn't matter who's in power in Congress or who's in power in the White House, the socialist agenda, world government, is always served. The contract with America? What contract with America? What did that Republican Congress give us that they promised? Well, ladies and gentlemen, absolutely nothing. 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 And they keep talking about their contract with America as if they fulfilled it. They never did. And it wasn't their idea anyway. They instituted a poll amongst Republicans across the country to find out what the silly people who follow these Judas goats wanted them to do when they got in Congress. Then they sat down and said they were going to do it. Then they got in Congress and they didn't do any of it. Nothing. Nothing. Now listen to me. There's not a dime's worth of difference between the Republicans and Democrats. None at all. And if you study the history of Newt Gingrich, it's a joke. Newt Gingrich is a New Age socialist. Always has been, always will be. To think that he represents freedom-loving Americans is ludicrous. Absolutely ludicrous. He could switch parties tomorrow and you wouldn't even know the difference. None of you would. Now stop listening to what they say. You see, this is where you all get hung up. Stop listening to what they say and instead watch what they do. And follow the agenda that is being served and then you will know the truth. I see Americans all over this country tell me that they know all politicians are liars. And then a few minutes later, after I know that they've forgotten that they made that statement, I'll ask them about what their particular party is doing in Washington, and they'll come out with this big recitation about what their congressman and their senator and the good people that they've elected and they're such wonderful representatives are doing for them. And then, stuffing or holding back just absolute maniacal laughter, I then remind them that they just got through telling me that all politicians are liars and all Americans know it, and it's become an accepted fact. How could they possibly stand there and tell me all that stuff as if they really believe it? And they get this weird, strange look on their face as if, how dare you think that my congressman would tell a lie? It's incredible. Absolutely. Incredible, ladies and gentlemen. Now, get ready. Here come some facts. Remember, this is Look Magazine. A left-wing, socialist-owned and operated magazine, Look Magazine, served the socialist agenda in this country for many years. Published May 28, 1968, and here's the article. Here's the article. Are you ready, folks? Are you ready, all you little socialists out there who listen to this broadcast every night and claim the next day that you never do? See, I know that you do because you are masochists, all of you. You love to be flogged. And so, once again tonight, I will flog you. Get ready. Take off your shirt if you don't want to get blood on it. Bend over because here it comes. I am raising my whip now. Quote, America's Concentration Camps, The Rumors and the Realities by William Hedgepeth. Look, Senior Editor. Senior editors never write anything unless they're trying to give you a message, ladies and gentlemen. They write editorials at the most, and usually not very often. Clang bang, she clapped her hands two times sharply to put added crack in the staccato of each word. And there you'll be, and you bet your sweet bippy you won't get let out till old LBJ and the boys are good and ready. The girl's eyes peered fiercely out of a face so thick caked with makeup that she seemed to be wearing a death mask of herself. She shifted her weight in the black thigh-high boots she said she wore to cover cop-inflicted scrapes and bruises earned downtown at a San Francisco demonstration along with other student new leftists. Hands on hips, chin thrust, she stamped out the words coldly. They haven't built 37 of those camps for nothing, you know. A torrent of low, fragmented murmurs erupted behind her. 37, and some indistinct mumble, police state. More mumble. You watch. You just watch. The mutterings poured from the huddled clump of faceless gray figures who sat around the floor near the dirty window as the final faintest glow of sundown darkened. It's coming, man. Hey, man. It's coming. You can see it coming, offered a young Negro voice from among the dim silhouettes. Soon it's going to be clang, bang, into the clinker. Bang, clang, bang, groaned some of the others to themselves in solemn affirmative response, like a deranged Greek chorus. Another voice, some days later, 3,000 miles east.
What you mean, am I serious?
The Negro gave a querulous, squinting look. He cocked his head like a cross-examining attorney.
Only way this system know how to put people down is by hitting them with clubs. Mace, tear gas, and them 24 concentration camps ain't sitting out there for nothing. The blacks can't fill up 24 camps. It's me and you, man. Me and you.
A small group of young men and women, five or six little boys, two dogs, and a hen, had gathered around us on the street. Amen, one said. Others nodded. 37, 24, 10, 6, 500, etc., etc. The total may vary. Everyone may not agree on the particulars, and many may not have heard of Title II of the McCarran Act, but the basic bleak theme of mass imprisonment is consistent and consistently spreading coast to coast. These soundings of dread are not new. They echo of an earlier time, another world. Quote, in the background, to be sure, there lurked the fear of the concentration camp for those who got out of line, or who had been communists, or socialists, or too liberal, or too pacifist, or who were Jews. End quote. From the rise and fall of the Third Reich. From the rise and fall of the Third Reich. The only thing they got wrong there was socialists. No socialists ever went to concentration camps in Germany. Unless they were Jews. It wasn't the socialists that did it. It was the being Jewish that did it in Hitler's hatred of anyone who was not of pure Aryan blood. Hitler was a socialist. I continue. In 1968, America, in the background, and to be sure, found most often among those who by birth or choice are out of line with the rest of the landscape, there lurks today a fear less strong, but no less real than that which held dissident Germans in abeyance. Obviously, no one knows of anyone else now locked away in some out-of-sight Americanized Auschwitz. But that the simmering mood of tension and distrust throughout the land allows such notions to prosper, to have the ring of potential plausibility for so many people, is in itself almost frightening. As always, rumors are plentiful, but not as always, many of today's listeners are somehow more receptive to any whispered grotesqueries that lend force to their own disillusionments about America. The result is a hardening polarity between the establishment and the disaffected. The result is a climate in which Texas Congressman Joe Poole, who is not taken seriously under normal conditions, can successfully poke an exposed nerve. Quote, under a declared state of war, he proclaimed before a Dallas audience, we could get the Attorney General to prosecute certain people for sedition and treason. Then if they, the peaceniks, persisted in their actions, the Justice Department could move to put them into concentration camps and leave them there for the duration of the war. End quote. The swelling preponderance of new leftists, old leftists, hippies, pacifists, protesters, and the vocal disgruntled in general not only are cold-eyed certain that the federal government is ready and waiting to clap them into mass detention camps, but they are also vaguely suspicious of anyone who even suggests otherwise. Right-wing conspiracy theorists, indeed. This is too funny, folks. This is too funny. I mean, this is just I'm really having a good time here. In the eyes of these radical groups, what? I thought the right was the radical group. I thought it was the militias. Ah, man, come on. And this is a left-wing magazine saying it. In the eyes of these radical groups, the concentration camp threat springs from sheer sinister lunacy on the part of a dying establishment. Black ghetto dwellers, however, view it as a logical extension of white belligerence. Now it's the whites. Yeah. Now it's the whites. With summer coming on and all that that entails, and with city police now equipping themselves as if they expected to take on the Viet Cong, concentration camp talk in black urban areas is rising to the level of a full-blown phobia. I see a ghetto perhaps cordoned off into a concentration camp, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. told me 6 days before he was killed. Now, is there anyone out there who wants to tell me Dr. Martin Luther King was a right-wing militia? Anybody want to tell me that? Any of you socialists got a carton of eggs big enough to get on the phone and tell me that lie? Hmm? Any one of you? No, I didn't think so. I see a ghetto perhaps cordoned off into a concentration camp, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. told me 6 days before he was killed. I haven't said there was a move afoot, just that it is a possibility. The more there are riots, the more repression will take place, and the more we face the danger of a right-wing takeover. A right-wing takeover. And eventually, a fascist society. It is chiefly the black nationalist groups, said Dr. King, who think the government is preparing particular geographical areas for concentration camp use. They are absolutely convinced of this. I don't think this is the spreading of a false rumor. It's something they really believe, he said. Out of this heavy, rumor-fed fog, is there anything really believable to begin with? Consider the sources. New left anarchists, hippie dropouts, black militants, riot-minded Negroes, and assorted young romantic revolutionaries who thrill at the thought of a put-down by powers that be. Notice, folks, none of those people could even remotely be considered to be right-wing. And I continue. And consider some of the tales that the federal government can legally imprison pacifists, rioters, or dissenters en masse. That there may be concentration camps out in the hinterland. That things are being made ready for a sort of nationwide martial law. Few of the advocates are able to say anything for certain. It's mostly a collection of ambient jabber and uncomfortable notions so bizarre they're believable. The uneasiness and fear are based on this believability. But the believability is based, at least in part, on fact. Did you hear that? Let me read it to you again for those of you who have eyes but cannot see through the radio. Remember, I gave you the source. You can go find it. Look it up for yourself. As I always do, I tell you where to go to get it. Listen to this, ladies and gentlemen. Few of the advocates are able to say anything for certain. It's mostly a collection of ambient jabber and uncomfortable notions so bizarre they're believable. The uneasiness and fear are based on this believability. But the believability is based, at least in part, on fact. Your guess is as good as mine, the man shrugged. One can always envision the invoking of a statute on the books if the proper conditions arise. I had asked the chief counsel for a United States Senate subcommittee about the likelihood of invoking Title II, Section 100 of the Internal Security Act of 1950, known also as the McCarran Act. Title II is a relatively unknown, hitherto unused measure. It is the legal authority by which an order of the President, the United States government, can place and hold American citizens in detention camps. Want me to read that again to you also? It is the legal authority by which an order of the president, the United States government, can place and hold American citizens in detention camps. Title II, known as the Emergency Detention Act, gives the president power to proclaim an internal security emergency in the event of any one of the following. 1. Invasion of the territory of the United States or its possessions. 2. Declaration of war by Congress. Or 3. Insurrection within the United States in aid of a foreign enemy. While this emergency is in effect, the president, acting through the Attorney General, is hereby authorized to apprehend and by order detain each person as to whom there is reasonable ground to believe that such person probably will engage in or probably will conspire with others to engage in acts of espionage or of sabotage. Hold on, folks. We're going to change the tape.